I guess I just must be a daredevil. I don't feel anything until I smash it up.
Hello and welcome to week 4 of Seminar in Literature, the Short Story. This is the only class this semester I'm teaching where the wearing of pants is optional. You'd be glad to know. All right, this week we will be focusing on Sherwood Anderson's seminal short story cycle, Winesburg, Ohio. This week's musical guest is Fiona Apple with selections from her new album, and I gotta take a deep breath here. The idler wheel is wiser than the driver of the screw, and whipping cords will serve you more than ropes will ever do, right? Which everyone just calls the idler wheel because that's too ridiculous. This is Apple's fourth album. Her first title was a huge commercial and critical hit back in 1996, and her song Criminal won a Grammy that year. This new album is her first since 2005 and represents a departure. It's a less melodic album, if any of you know her work, and not as lushly produced as some of her earlier ones. It sounds to me like she's been listening to a lot of Tom Waits and has been drawn to kind of less pretty but nonetheless memorable tunes. But it's an album that rewards multiple listens, and it's been a regular in my car's CD player ever since I bought it, and my kids have come to like this one much more than the Patti Smith album I also picked up recently, which they won't let me listen to in the car because they said, this is not age-appropriate language for us, which I think is true. So, okay, enough of that. I have been asked to make an announcement. If any of you have students that you're teaching who may be interested in attending UNI, there's going to be what's called a peak day for the College of Humanities, Arts, and Sciences on Monday, October 22nd, from 8 a.m. to 1:30. The schedule includes visits with faculty and students in the major or majors you're interested in, as well as a chance to tour the campus and meet counselors and admissions. So if you know of any students you think might be interested in UNI or be in a good school for them, send them our way. We would be glad to have them. In fact, we need them right now, or not been a good enrollment year for us. For more information, contact Celeste Bembry at the email on the screen there. Okay, if you have any questions about that, feel free to contact me. Before we get into the work that you're doing for this week, I just wanted to make a few comments about our discussion last week. We began by examining the Kate Chopin story of an hour, and looked at some sample student responses to that text. And then I asked you to give some feedback to these students for expanding their responses into a formal paper. And it was striking to me, as I said, that those of you who viewed your audience as being a student responded very differently than those of you who viewed me as the audience. Those writing to a student instinctively tried to find something positive in the response and to use that positive thing as the base to build from. Those who were writing to me were just more likely to point out problems with the response. And, you know, that difference seems appropriate since our actions, of course, tend to be guided by our expectations, which is exactly what happens in Story of an Hour. All right, how's that for a segue? Mrs. Mallard's scope of possible reactions is shaped by her expectations. She may have long felt a low, simmering unhappiness with her marriage, but she had accepted that state as inevitable, or at least as better than any other possible alternative. However, when she hears of her husband's death, her scope of possibility greatly expands in terms of what she thinks she might be able to do, which surprises even her. I think this is a good story to teach because it rewards and even necessitates examining specific details from the text to make a point about it. So it's very teachable in that sense, and of course very short, so it's a nice assignment to do within an individual class. Now after the break, people moved into the breakout rooms and worked in small groups on individual stories. And in each case, groups were asked to come up with both a set of teaching strategies and some general questions for readers. Now, I would say I don't think all these stories would work equally well in the classroom. Today, I think A White Heron is a really interesting story, but the first time I read it, I thought it was a real yawner. I think that might not be one that goes over well with a younger group. Conversely, The Yellow Wallpaper has the kind of riveting narrative that makes it, like the stories of Poe, a popular classroom text in both secondary and college classrooms. And finally, the last question I raise is whether there was any kind of continuity that emerges when reading this series of female writers, all of whom were publishing around the same historical period. Feminist critics have drawn attention to these writers, and their often subtle but implicit critique of patriarchal culture. Like the characters in many of their stories, these writers were more likely to critique by inference rather than by confrontation, whether by drawing attention to the double standards applied to men's and women's roles, as in Desiree's Baby and The Yellow Wallpaper, or by showing the psychological impact when one's social role is out of sorts with one's needs and desires. And I think you can see that in Paul's case and also in Story of an Hour, and of course in Yellow Wallpaper. And on occasion, we're given a glimpse into what an alternate non-patriarchal model might look like, as in A White Heron, when Sylvia refuses to reveal the location of the prized bird out of a kind of sense of solidarity and community that even she can't quite put into words. But I will say, and this one for you to consider, that some alternate models for living appear, particularly in these writers' longer works, and I would point to Kate Chopin's The Awakening, Charlotte Perkins Gilman's utopian novel Her Land, and Willa Cather's My Antonia. And I will put those titles up then on the screen while Fiona Apple plays us out of this section.
I could liken you to a werewolf the way you left me for dead. But I admit that I provided a full moon. And I could liken you to a shark the way you bit off my head. But then again, I was waving around a bleeding open wound. But you were such a super guy till the second you get away from me. We're like a wishing well and a bolt of electricity. But we can still support each other. All we gotta do is avoid each other. Nothing wrong with a song ends in a minor key.
Okay, let me start with an outrageous claim. In terms of literary history, Winesburg, Ohio is perhaps the most important collection of short stories ever published. All right, I'll let that one sink in. It's a bit of a stretch, but only a bit, and it got your attention. So this book by Sherwood Anderson has come to be seen as one of the foundational documents of literary modernism. Furthermore, it unintentionally created the concept of the short story cycle, and if that wasn't enough, it has become a touchstone within the field of Midwestern literature. Now don't worry if you didn't get all that the first time through. I'm going to go through those claims one at a time in just a minute. But I feel I need to overstate them, because Anderson is taught and discussed less now than he used to be. Because his style of modernism wasn't quite as formally experimental as the writing that followed by figures such as Ernest Hemingway, upon whom Anderson was a huge influence, he is a figure too easily passed over.